Today we're going to be talking about the third angel's message and separation. The last 2 weeks we've been looking at the third angel's message of these three. We've already looked at some of the first and second angel's messages. But the 2 weeks prior, the two studies prior to this study today, was on the third angel's message in perfection. But today we want to look at how the third angel's message is also a separating message. You see, beloved, God raised the Advent movement up in 1844 to prepare and perfect a people for the second coming of Jesus Christ. They would be a people who would live the gospel, live the true gospel, and share that message. Excuse me. This demonstration that they would make would not only bring glory and honor to God, but would vindicate the character of God to a universe that has been watching diligently. And as this gospel is given, there is occurring, even right now, a polarization in the world. Do you know what I mean when I say polarization? We're seeing people move away from the center to the two far extreme ends, one of righteousness and one of wickedness, one of total purity and one of total evil. And as this gospel is given, some will accept the message and some will reject it. And depending upon our acceptance or our rejection is going to determine the direction we move in that polarization. And this polarization will soon, one day, be finished. It will be complete. And all the people on the earth, friends, will have made an eternal decision. And that's when the sanctuary is going to close in heaven. The three angels' messages of Revelation 14 are designed to fully accomplish the ripening process in the perfection of the character of the saints. Turn with me, if you would, to Malachi chapter 3, verses 2 and 3. Here we have these verses, and they're actually quoted in the book Great Controversy. We're going to read these as a lead-in to a quotation. And said the prophet, "Who shall abide the day of his coming? And who shall stand when he appeareth? For he is like a refiner's fire, and like fuller's soap. And he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. And he shall purify the sons of Levi, and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness." And then Ellen White, after quoting these words, notes, she says, "Those who are living upon the earth, when the intercession of Christ shall cease in the sanctuary above, are to stand in the sight of a holy God without a mediator." You know, beloved, sometimes it's fearful, the thoughts of standing before a holy God, even with a mediator. But it says that there's going to be a group of people that will stand before a holy God without a mediator. And that means, friends, that if we are going to be saved at last when Jesus comes, we're going to have to be ready fully at that time. Amen. We can't wait for Jesus to come and miraculously change us, to take our vile characters away and give us a good character, because he doesn't do that. Character isn't given like that. Character is something that is developed. She goes on to continue, and she says this, and this is from Great Controversy, page 425 is the reference. "Their robes must be spotless. Their characters must be purified from sin by the blood of sprinkling. Through the grace of God and their own diligent effort, they must be conquerors in the battle with evil." And then she says, "While the investigative judgment is going forward in heaven, while the sins of penitent believers are being removed from the sanctuary, there is to be a special work of purification, of putting away of sin among God's people upon the earth. This work is more clearly presented in the messages of Revelation 14. Those messages of Revelation 14, the first, second, and third angels' messages. That's what we need, beloved. And that's what we need for the perfection of our character, so that sin can be put away. God has a desire for his people. If you turn to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 13, we read there about God's great desire for his people. And he says that he has given gifts to the church. And then he says, "Till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ." I've been in a dialogue with some brethren recently. We've been talking about unity and how we can work together better. But ultimately, friends, this is the solution that we all need. We need a unity of the faith and knowledge of the Son of God. Amen. And when we have those things, then we will be the place where God can bring us to the state of perfection. God wills for his people, beloved, to become perfect and to have the unity of the faith. Not just any faith, but the faith of Jesus. And this perfection and unity happens in those who accept and cooperate with the three angels' messages. These believers will be the ones who finally receive, friends, the seal of the living God. However, there's going to be a group of people who reject the three angels' messages. And they're going to worship another God, or at least another gospel. They will be religious, for sure, very religious. They will worship, for sure. But their worship will be either through a false god and or through a false gospel. Paul says emphatically in Galatians chapter 1 and verse 6 that there is another gospel besides the true gospel. Galatians chapter 1 verse 6, he says to the Galatians, he says, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. Another gospel, the Greek word is heteron, from heteros, and it simply means another of a different kind. It doesn't mean something that's alike, it's contrasting, it's something that's different. And these people in the day of Paul had moved from the gospel of Christ unto another gospel, and that gospel is the gospel of works, and that Paul was specifically dealing about here with these Galatian brethren. This other gospel, this heteros gospel, is a gospel that claims to offer salvation, because it wouldn't be called a gospel if it didn't offer salvation. But one of the great hallmarks of the false gospel that we will see so prominently in the last days is the denial of the power of God to help the believer to overcome sin. Speaking of the professed church in the last days, in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 5, Paul speaks there in the first four verses, delineating a long line of sins of the last days. But then in verse 5 he says, having a form of godliness, but denying what? The power thereof, from such turn away. And the power they're denying is the power to overcome those lists of sins that are mentioned there before that. And this is what we see in the last days. This other gospel is a gospel that doesn't give us the power to overcome sin. And these people, according to Revelation chapter 14, verse 9, friends, will ultimately receive not the seal of God, but the mark of the beast. Concerning the giving of the three angels' messages, Ellen White has written in early writings, pages 258 and 259. She says, I was shown three steps, the first, second, and third angels' messages. Said my accompanying angel, and may I just pause here to note that if you notice on your screen, there are quotation marks now. Do you see the quotation marks? And that means it's a verbatim statement, not just something that I think I remember him saying, this is what the angel told her. Woe to him who shall move a block or stir a pin of these messages. The true understanding of these messages is of vital importance. The destiny of souls hangs upon the manner in which they are received. The angel from heaven says there's a true understanding of these messages, and what does that surely imply? There's going to be a false understanding. There's going to be people who misinterpret them, misrepresent them, who don't take them for what they say. She goes on to say, I was again brought down through these messages and saw how dearly the people of God had purchased their experience. It had been obtained through much suffering and severe conflict. God had led them along step by step until He'd placed them upon a solid, immovable platform. She says that He moved them, but how? Step by step. But if you go back to the prior statement, she says, I was shown what? Three steps. What are those steps? Step by step, the first, second, third angel's message. We have a lot of people today who want to give the third angel's message who are afraid to speak about the second angel's message. Exactly right. Or they don't believe in the first angel's message about the hour of the judgments coming, the investigative judgment. In 1844, and shortly thereafter, God, friends, desired to lead a people step by step onto a firm, solid, immovable platform of truth. But for this platform of truth to be able to accomplish its goal, there was to be a corresponding experience with Christ that would be firmly grounded. Continuing two more slides, just going up to this one. the first angel's message. Remember we said the first, second, third angel's message? Ellen White tells us the purpose of the first angel's message. She says in Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 4, page 231, that it was to separate the Church of Christ from the corrupting influence of the world. And you notice here the fourth word in the quotation. What is that fourth word?
Separate.
Separate. It's a separation message, isn't it? It surely is. The second angel's message. Again, the Spirit of Prophecy helps us to understand its purpose and place in early writings, page 237. She says, as the churches refused to receive the first angel's message, they rejected the light from heaven and fell from the favor of God. They trusted to their own strength and by opposing the first message, placed themselves where they could not see the light of the second angel's message. But the beloved of God who were opposed accepted the message, Babylon is fallen, and what? Left the churches. They left those nominal churches. And so you see, friends, if you don't get the first angel's message, you won't see the necessity of the second angel's message. And we have so many people today say, well, why do I need to leave the church? You know, or a church, any church. It's because, friends, they don't see where the church has failed to keep in step with truth. What about the third angel? As with the first and second angel's messages, the third angel's message was to bring a separation. Ellen White, commenting upon those who accepted the first and second angel's messages, said that they were not free from errors. And I saw the mercy and goodness of God in sending a warning to the people of the earth and repeating messages to lead them to a diligent searching of heart and study of the scriptures that they might divest themselves from errors, which have been handed down from the heathen and papists. Through these messages, God has been bringing out his people where he can work for them in greater power and where they can keep all his commandments. God has been bringing them out. What does that mean? It means there's a separation. A separation. And in fact, she also noted this, and I like this statement. This is from Manuscript Release, Volume 5, page 291. She says, when you have been baptized with the third angel's message, the soul purifying truth for this time will make a separation between you and the world. Now, there's a little simple phraseology here used. When you are baptized with. We think of getting baptized in water, right? We think of the minister lowering us down. But here it says when you get baptized in the third angel's message. What does that mean? Baptism, friends, is a symbol of the life, burial, and death, a resurrection of Christ. And we die to sin with him and we're raised with him, right? But when you baptize something, literally the Greek word means to immerse. And when you are immersed into this message so that it's a part of you and you live it and you breathe it, then you are immersed and then it brings a separation between you and the world. In Manuscript Release, Volume 15, page 362, MR 15, page 362, I like this. The third angel's message is infallible. It is, friends. It is to unite. Now, here's something else. It does not only separates, but it unites. It is to unite a people to do a special work, preparing them with perfection of character to unite in one great family in the mansions Christ has gone to prepare for those who love him. So it has a separating influence, but it also has a uniting influence. It unites the people that are going to find perfection of character together. And so we see that all three messages were to bring about a work of separation. The message of the first angel was to separate people from the corrupting influences of the world and from the known sins. The second angel's message was to separate the people from the corrupt churches that rejected the first angel's message. And the third angel's message was to separate the people from every corrupt error as well as from a love of the world. These messages will result in perfection of character, and God will be able to present a group of people to the universe whose lives are changed by these messages. He's going to be able to present these people, Alan, you, Larry, all of us, if we will follow these messages, he's going to be able to present us, and he's going to be able to say to the universe, here is the patience of the saints, Revelation 14, 12. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Not just simply those who profess them, not just those who teach them or advocate them. These are people who keep. They keep the commandments of God. They keep the faith of Jesus. is a part of their lives. It's a part of their being and who and what they are now. This group will have the genuine faith of Jesus and will live above the corruptions of both the world and of the churches. This group has the Father's name written in their foreheads. They are partakers of the new covenant experience. And here's what God can say about them in Jeremiah chapter 31 and verse 33. Jeremiah 31, 33. He says, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. What a blessing. I want you to notice now a little bit more about this group. In Revelation chapter 14, we're going to read verses 1 through 5 here. Revelation 14, 1 through 5. And John says, and by the way, here in Revelation 14, you have in the beginning of this chapter, God's response to this issue of the mark of the beast in Revelation chapter 13. Remember? And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his Father's name written in their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven, as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of a great thunder, and I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And then verse 3, and they sung, as it were, a new song before the throne and before the four beasts and the elders, and no man can learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. And then verses 4 and 5, these are they which are not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the firstfruits unto God and to the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. Revelation 14, 5. Besides having the Father's name written in their foreheads, John sees, as recorded in verses 4 and 5, a description that is a specific character trait of the 144,000. He says that they have a description that tells us that they are without guile, that they are virgins, and they are a special group of people. Now, the first characteristic is that actually they're virgins, and they're not defiled with women. In the Bible, we know that a woman is symbolic of a church. Jeremiah 6:2, Revelation 12:1, Revelation 17:1. If it's a pure woman, it represents the pure church or God's true church. If it's a harlot or a wicked woman, it represents Satan's church, a corrupt church. Those who are corrupted by the woman in Revelation 14:4 must be in association with the corrupt churches, but God's people will refuse to associate with these harlots, and neither will they support this harlotry with their means, I believe. Revelation 17:2 and 18:9, in these verses, God condemns a church which has an unlawful relationship with the kings of the earth, using them to either support her or protect her good name, or prosecute those who side with those that she considers to be heretics or dissidents. To be loyal both to Christ and to a church not following Christ, friends, is impossible. You can't be loyal to Christ and loyal to a church that doesn't follow Christ. You can't do both. We either choose one or the other. And Jesus has told us very plainly that he will not accept a divided service. The 144,000 will follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. Revelation 14:4. This is not a corrupt church, friends, playing a harlot. Another characteristic of the 144,000 in verse 5 says that they have no guile in their mouth. The Greek word for guile is dolus, which means bait or deceit. And this word is also used in Isaiah 53 and verse 9 in the Septuagint about Christ, that there was no deceit found in him. Just as Jesus is, his people are going to be. Now, since all false doctrine is deceitful, though 144,000 have given up all their false doctrines, including errors about God, errors about his character, errors about the Sabbath, errors concerning righteousness by faith, errors concerning God's government and purposes for humanity, the 144,000, friends, have made a decision to give up every known sin in their lives, to follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. And yet today, they may still have many character defects that are being revealed to them, one step at a time. Step by step. And God is working with those people. He's working with me. I hope he's working with you to reveal these character defects so that we may eliminate them step by step. If we were to say, and I want you to think about this for a minute, if we were to say that there was one area of our characters that just couldn't be made right, have you heard people say, well, you know, I would like to overcome this problem, but I just can't seem to get the victory over it? When we say that there's one, just even one area of our character that can't be perfected, what we're saying, in effect, is that there is some place or problem in the authority and power of Christ to help us to overcome sin. Isn't that right? Because after all, it's not because we can overcome sin of ourselves, it's as the work of Christ in us. And if I say I can't overcome my temper, I can't overcome this lust, or I can't overcome this wrong habit, I'm saying that Christ can't help me to do that. But He can, if we will simply surrender it to Him and turn it over to Him, give it to Him, then He will help us to be able to overcome. Step by step, friends, He is leading people along, and their growth is a result of acceptance and submission to the three angels' messages. In Testimonies for the Church, Volume 1, on page 187, it says, God leads His people on step by step. We read that earlier, didn't we? Something like that, right? He brings them up to different points calculated to manifest what is in the heart. Some endure at one point, but fall off at the next. At every advanced point, the heart is tested and tried a little closer. If the professed people of God find their hearts opposed to this straight work, it should convince them that they have a work to do to overcome, if they would not be spewed out of the mouth of the Lord. And what's he making reference to there at the end? The Laodiceans, right. Continuing, said the angel, and here we have quote marks again. Pay attention to quote marks, they're pretty important. God will bring his work closer and closer to test and prove every one of his people. Some are willing to receive one point, but when God brings them to another testing point, they shrink from it and stand back because they find that it strikes directly at some cherished idol. Here they have opportunity to see what is in their hearts that shuts out Jesus. They prize something higher than the truth, and their hearts are not prepared to receive Jesus. Individuals are tested and proved a length of time to see if they will sacrifice their idols and heed the counsel of the true witness. Did you get it? That's a pretty strong statement. That we are tested and proved a length of time. Usually the testing just doesn't happen one time. It's over a length of time. She continues. She says, if any will not be purified through obeying the truth and overcome their selfishness, their pride and evil passions, the angels of God have the charge. They are joined to their idols, let them alone. And they pass on to their work, leaving these with their sinful traits unsubdued to the control of evil angels. Let me just pause here. How does she say that we are purified? Obeying the truth. Did Jesus say something about sanctifying the people through truth? Oh yes, we'll see it in a minute. And she says, though, that if we don't want to be sanctified by obeying the truth, we will be finally left over to who? To evil angels. That's a scary thought, friends. We don't want that. We don't want that. She says, those who come up to every point and stand every test and overcome, be the price what it may, have heeded the counsel of the true witness, and they will receive the latter rain and thus be fitted for translation. Do you want to be ready for translation?
Amen.
You have to have what to do that? The latter rain to fit you for that. And to get that latter rain, you've got to be willing to purify the soul by being obedient to all the truth. Isn't that right? Beloved, if we cherish sin and cling to any false doctrine, or if we refuse to be separated from any character defect, we will not be prepared for the time ahead. And we will, positively for sure, accept the mark of the beast rather than die. But the testimony of God is sure in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 11. He says, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. It doesn't matter, friends, if we lose our temporal lives on this world or not. That's so insignificant compared to the light of eternity, when time will be no more. Today, many, I'll just put it this way, many corporate churches, and you can apply it if it fits, by their lack of true spirit of Christ, by their false teaching such as the Trinity, and by their refusal to separate from the world, they are preparing their people to accept the mark of the beast in their foreheads or in their hands. Jesus said, and here we go, John 17:17, sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. That's right. So that's how our character is going to be perfected, through sanctified by obedience to the truth. And all this idea that obedience is not important, friends. The serious nature of this truth should not be overlooked, either intellectually or experientially. And it will not be by the 144,000. No matter what our profession, friends, if we reject part of the message and do not allow it to work in our hearts, we will at last accept the mark of the beast. In Great Controversy on page 608, we read these words, as the storm approaches, as the storm approaches. I'm not talking about the winter snow squall, are we? We're not talking about a hurricane here. But friends, all we have to do is look at the signs of the times, and we can see that the storm is approaching now. As the storm approaches, just a small minority of the dissidents give up the message. Those who left the church give up the message. Is that what it says? As the storm approaches, a large class who have professed faith in the third angel's message, but have not been sanctified through obedience to the truth, abandon their position and join the ranks of the opposition. And you can just be as sure as anything that that is happening even now and going to happen for sure in large force very soon. By uniting with the world and partaking of its spirit, they have come to view matters in nearly the same light. And when the test is brought, they are prepared. Oh yes, they're prepared. They are prepared to choose the easy, popular side. Great Controversy, page 608. Because friends, we're all being prepared step by step. We're being prepared step by step, either for the seal of God or for the mark of the beast. It's one or the other. There won't be any sitting on the fence in those days. The three angels' messages will prepare people to stand in the presence of a holy God without a mediator. And friends, sin is what defiles, and if we cling to sin, we will finally be destroyed with sin. Those who cling to their sins will never have the joy of eternity with God in heaven. All will be finally separated from either sin by their choice now or by destruction later. In Deuteronomy chapter 30 and verse 19, God makes an appeal to his people. He says, choose life that both thou and thy seed may live. There's hope in that. I like this verse because there's hope in it not only for us but for our children that thy seed may live. What we do has a great bearing upon what our seed does many times. I found this a wonderful statement, Bible Training School, December 1, 1903. It says, the work of the Holy Spirit is to convince the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. The world can only be warned by seeing those who believe the truth, sanctified through the truth, acting upon high and holy principles, showing in a high, elevated sense the line of demarcation between those who keep the commandments of God and those who trample them under their feet. How is the world going to be warned? Is the world going to be warned primarily through preaching? Is it going to be warned through giving a poultice? Is it going to be warned through having a Bible study? You know, this is an amazing concept. She says that at least in part, one of the great ways, if not the primary way, that the world is going to come to see this message is either true and they're going to accept it or not, they'll see it's true, she says, is by seeing those who believe the truth sanctified through the truth. It's seeing us changed. You know, Paul in 2 Corinthians 3 says that your epistle is known and read of all men. And Ellen White tells us that one of the greatest arguments for the Christian religion, in fact, some places she says the greatest argument for the Christian religion, is a loving and lovable Christian, someone who's truly been converted. And that's what's going to take for people to see that this is the truth. Well, I want you to turn your Bibles with me now to 2 Corinthians chapter 6. And we're going to read verses 14 through 18. And then we'll look at a thought in closing. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? Continuing, and what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. Particularly verses 16 and 17 here are important. It says, come out. God's made a promise in verse 18. In verse 18, he says, I will be a father unto you. But that's conditional upon our obeying verse 17. And what does verse 17 say? It says, come out from among the wicked and the unrighteous. And after quoting these verses, in Testimonies for the Church, volume 5, page 13, Ellen White says, these, referring back to verses 17, 18 of 2 Corinthians 6, she says, these are the conditions upon which we may be acknowledged as the sons of God, separation from the world and renunciation of those which delude and fascinate and ensnare. And then she says, the Apostle Paul declares that it is impossible for the children of God to unite with worldlings. The Apostle Paul declares that it is impossible for the children of God to unite with worldlings. So if we unite with the worldlings, what does that mean about us? We are no longer the children of God, friends. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. This does not refer to marriage alone. We use it for that a lot, and it has its place there, but it doesn't refer to marriage alone. Any intimate relation of confidence and co-partnership with those who have no love for God or the truth is a snare. And let me just say this, by the way, because this is the time of year people are really concerned about this. We're just about to the end of the year. And people next month, starting next month, are going to start filling out 1040s. Do you know what a 1040 is? It's like those tax forms, right? And here in America, people are going to do some itemization. They're going to put down those charitable deductions. And the ones that they're really going to be concerned about are the ones that they get the little receipts from these groups that are called 501c3 corporations. But you have to understand that a 501c3 is a corporation. It's an agreement between the church and the government. That the government is allowing the church to exist as it is under certain privileges and opportunities that only the government allows it to be afforded. Do you think that's a type of co-partnership? Is it some kind of an intimate relation? I think it is, friends. I do. In Testimonies for the Church, volume 4, on page 109. The first 30 years of Christ's life were passed in retirement. Ministering angels waited upon the Lord of life as he walked side by side with the peasants and laborers among the hills of Nazareth, unrecognized and unhonored. These noble examples should teach us to avoid evil influences and to shun the society of those who do not live outright. We should not flatter ourselves that we are too strong for any such influences to affect us, but we should, in humility, guard ourselves from danger. Ancient Israel were especially directed by God to be and remain a people separate from all nations. They were not to be subjected to witnessing the idolatry of those about them, lest their hearts should be corrupted, lest familiarity with ungodly practices should make them appear less wicked in their eyes. Few realize their own weakness and that the natural sinfulness of the human heart too often paralyzes their noblest endeavors. Do you see, friends, why God says you have to come out and be separate? It's not that God doesn't love everybody. It's not that God doesn't want people help. There's a place to witness. There's a way to reach out to everybody. But if we become a part of this, if we become entangled with evil, whether it's evil in the church or evil in the world, we will soon cease to see the sinfulness of sin. And it will seem to be just fine and part of the common everyday allowances, you know. And we could go through a long list, I think, of lifestyle practices and life habits that people do that we see in the world all the time, but now we see also in the church. And because it now gets baptized in the church, it seems to be acceptable. But friends, only what is specified in this book is acceptable. Nothing else. You know, Paul says that when we compare ourselves by ourselves, we're not wise. Because if I start to look to Sister Arlene for my standard, and you look to me for your standard, you're looking at the wrong place. We need to look to the Lord Jesus and what His Word says. Because the sure word of prophecy will never fail us. And especially the prophecies of the first, second, and third angels' messages. And so friends, if you understand that these messages are calling for you to separate, to make certain separations in your life. We just heard a mission report from these two brothers at Encore, was Encore Island, I believe. And they were saying that some of the people there were just crying and weeping because, like, we've learned this truth, but it's like our church doesn't accept it and we're going to have to come out from our churches. And it seems like a really hard thing. I'm going to tell you something, friends. There's going to come a day, according to Revelation chapter 20, when every person who's ever been alive on this earth is going to be alive again. And there's going to be a great number of people outside of the New Jerusalem, outside of salvation, outside of the protection of God in Christ. And you know, at that time, they're going to weep and wail and wish they had come out. They're going to wish that they had obeyed the first, second, and third angels' messages when they had a chance. I don't want that to be said about me, and I don't want to be a false shepherd and not make sure that you have the opportunity to know what God's Word says on these matters, and that you will dedicate your life to serving Him and to having your character perfected and your life sanctified through obedience to the truth. May God bless you lots and lots.